Blackstone Audio presents The Kreutzer Sonata by Leo Tolstoy. This book is read by Simon Prebble. Chapter 1. But I say unto you that every one that looketh on a woman to lust after her hath committed adultery with her already in his heart. Matthew, verse 28. The disciples say unto him, If the case of the man is so with his wife, it is not expedient to marry. But he said unto them, All men cannot receive this saying, but they to whom it is given. For there are some eunuchs, which were so born from their mother's womb, and there are some eunuchs which were made eunuchs of men, and there be eunuchs which have made themselves eunuchs for the kingdom of heaven's sake. He that is able to receive it, let him receive it. Matthew chapter 19, verses 10 to 12. It was early spring. We'd been travelling for more than 24 hours. Passengers with tickets for more or less distant places had been entering and leaving our carriage. But there were four of us who had been on the train from the very start. A weary-faced lady, neither beautiful nor young, who wore a hat and a semi-masculine paletot, and smoked cigarettes. Her companion, a talkative man of 40 with neat new luggage. And thirdly, a rather short and very reserved gentleman, not by any means old, but with curly hair prematurely turning grey, with very nervous motions, and with extraordinarily brilliant eyes, which kept roving from object to object. He wore an old paletot with a lamb's wool collar made by an expensive tailor, and a high lamb's wool hat. Under his paletot, when it was thrown open, were visible a pudyavka, or sleeveless kaftan, and a Russian embroidered shirt. The peculiarity of this gentleman consisted in the fact that he from time to time produced strange noises, like a cough or like a laugh begun and broken off. This gentleman, during the whole journey, had carefully avoided all acquaintance and intercourse with the other passengers. If any of his neighbours spoke to him, he replied briefly and stiffly. And for the most part, he either read or smoked, gazing out of the window, or else, getting his provisions out of his old sack, drank tea or ate luncheon. It seemed to me that he was oppressed by his loneliness, and several times I was tempted to speak with him. But whenever our eyes met, as often happened since we sat diagonally opposite each other, he turned away and devoted himself to his book or looked out of the window. During one stop at a large station just before the evening of our second day, this nervous gentleman left the carriage to get some hot water and made himself some tea. The gentleman with the neat new luggage, a lawyer, as I afterward learned, went out also with the cigarette-smoking lady in the semi-masculine paletot to drink tea in the station. During the absence of the gentleman and lady, several new persons entered our carriage, and among them a tall, closely shaven, wrinkled old man, evidently a merchant, in a skunk-lined coat and a cloth cap with a huge visor. This merchant sat down opposite the lawyer and immediately entered into conversation with a young man, apparently a merchant's prikashchik, or manager, who entered the carriage at the same station. I was sitting diagonally opposite, and while the train was stationary and no one was passing between us, I could hear snatches of their conversation. The merchant at first explained that he was on his way to an estate of his, which was situated only one station distant. Then, as usual, they began to talk about prices, about trade, and how Moscow does business at the present time. And then they discussed the fair at Nizhny Novgorod. The merchant's clerk began to tell about the merrymaking at the fair, of some rich merchant whom both of them knew. But the old man did not let him finish. He began to tell about the merrymakings which had taken place in former times at Kuanovino, and which he himself had enjoyed. He was evidently proud of the share which he had taken in them, and with manifest delight he related how he and this same common acquaintance had once got drunk at Kuanovino, and played such tricks that he had to tell about it in a whisper, whereat the clerk burst into a hearty fit of laughter which filled the whole carriage, and the old man also laughed, displaying two yellow teeth. Not expecting to hear anything interesting, I got up to go out on the platform.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.